And today I have a very difficult person because I need all the grace of God to talk about that person. And that person is none other than Mary, mother of Jesus. I pray that there will be a great clarity, because that is the greatest controversy, you know. Because unfortunately, I would dare say that the devil has put that thought in the minds of many people that believers are against Mother Mary. People are, you know, born again people, or people who want to lead their life exactly according to the word of God, they hate Mary. But I want to tell you something. I personally feel, and I'm sure all of you feel the same thing, if there is one human being who was closest to Jesus, it was Mother Mary. She was a human being who offered a life unconditionally so that the plan of God could be fulfilled by Jesus being born here. Because God's word says in the book of Philippians chapter 2 that he gave up his divinity and was born like one amongst us. Just like any one of us. And Mother Mary, not looking at the consequences, she offered a life to Jesus. She's one person we have to really emulate. There's a great difference between emulating and worshipping. We have to emulate the life of Mother Mary. So let us go through, some scriptures. See, it can never be an exhaustive thing. In one hour, I want to finish. Because, the more you can, I don't want any controversies. Because today, my dear brother, my dear sister, I want to tell you again and again. We believers respect and love Mother Mary as one of the greatest persons who were alive. Because she was a very simple person who offered a life to the plan of God. And she gave birth to the greatest person that was born on this face of the earth. And his name is Jesus. So if you look at why did God choose Mother Mary for that particular task? Look, I want to tell you, each one of us have a task, have a purpose in creation. I would say it is because one of the greatest reasons why God would have chosen Mary to be the mother of Jesus, because Jesus needed a biological mother, was because God foreknew her receptivity to the word. Are you with me? Today many people question the word. They argue with the word. But God knew here was a person who would be totally receptive to the God's word. Again, God knew her humility. Totally humble person. And again, God knew that she was a perfect servant. Today I want to tell you, my dear brother, my sister, that you and I can experience a visitation from God if we are able to have the qualities that Mother Mary had. So you'll find that God, first of all, you find there was great favor of God upon her. Are you with me? Because when Gabriel came, you find in the book of Luke chapter 1 verse 28, Gabriel addresses her saying, "Oh, most highly favored one." I'll just read the word. Because today you must pray in the spirit that this message will go through clear. So that any misunderstanding that people have about what we as believers consider the status of Mother Mary in our belief, people must have a clear understanding. Because often people just do not want to listen to you because they feel unconsciously that you are against Mother Mary. I want to tell you again and again, I want to emphasize, my dear brother, my sister, we are not against Mother Mary. We just love her as much as you love her. Hallelujah. The book of Luke chapter 1 verses 28. There was a visitation by angel, Archangel Gabriel, and he says to Mary, "And having come in, the angel said to her, 'Rejoice, highly favored one, the Lord is with you. Blessed are you among women.'" So there was a great favor of God upon her life because of her receptivity, because of her humility, because of her perfect servanthood. Today you and I can experience the same favor of God. Because I want to tell you, our God is not a person whose favorite is, he's got favorites. There is no favoritism for God. He only looks at your faith in God. So Mary, if you look at her from the worldly sense, she was not wealthy at all. I'm sure, she was just an ordinary, maybe even below. We have got our classification, IPL, BPL and all that. She would have been probably BPL. I don't know what IPL. IPL is also cricket. Forget it. Okay. So she was a very, very ordinary person. But she had great spiritual riches in her. There's a great spiritual treasure. Because as the word says, you know, a person found a field with a great pearl of great value. That person was willing to give up everything to possess that. Mother Mary was a person who had in her mind decided to give up everything so that she can possess that great pearl of a good relationship with God. She was a person, I'm sure, was not very beautiful. Though all the pictures that you see about Mother Mary, she probably is the most beautiful person. She probably, because the Bible never talks about that she was a beautiful lady. So she must have been a very ordinary person whom you would not even turn around and look, have a second look. She probably was not literate at all. Because the Bible does not talk about any education for her. So one has to go to to understand her as a person who would be in one of these villages we know. Just an ordinary village girl. And you must understand one thing. So in that situation, God found her to be the person who is favored to be the mother of his son Jesus. So you must understand one thing. God does not choose you for any calling depending upon your physical attributes. Are you with me? Or your capabilities. Or your abilities. Or whatever it is. God chooses you seeing your heart. Your availability. So today you and I, if we want to minister to God, what we need to do most is to have the same character of Mother Mary. That is receptivity to God's word, humility before God, and most of all, a willingness to be a perfect servant of God. Hallelujah. Because if you look at the calling, Mother Mary was called, probably they say, the Bible does not talk about the age, but considering the situation prevailing then, and also if you look at the situation that is prevailing even in Kerala, maybe about 100 years back, women, girls got married at the age of 13, 14, 15 and all that. So probably she was called at a young age, very young age, where she should be playing, you know, having a good time and all that. But the calling of God is not dependent upon the age either. Because you know another person who was called when he was very, very old. His name is Abraham. He was called when he was about 75. So age is also not a criteria for your call. Nor is your physical attribute. So I want to tell you, the only criteria is availability to God. Are you with me? Irrespective of your social standing, your age, your capabilities, none of them are relevant in the eyes of God. The only thing that is relevant in the eyes of God for you to be called is availability. Say availability. Say, Lord, I am available. Hallelujah. It's a commitment that you're making. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. So you'll find it was in this faith. And what was Mary's one of the things is she had such a great faith. Believing. The quality of faith was that believing that what God said would happen. That such faith she had. That is why Luke 1:45 it says, blessed is she who believed, for there will be fulfillment of those things which were told her from the Lord. So if you are a person who is willing to believe God's word, the blessing of God is automatic upon you. Are you with me? Please receive it in the spirit because God wants to bless each one of you. He says, blessed is she. God is not a favorite. If you are believing, I want to tell you, the same blessing will be upon your life. Hallelujah. He says, blessed is he, blessed is she who believed, for there will be fulfillment. Say fulfillment. Fulfillment of those things which were told her from the Lord. So I want to tell you, urge you once again, my dear brother, my dear sister, that if there is any promise, any covenant of God in this Bible, in the scriptures, and if you believed, it will come to fulfillment in your life. Because God says so. There is no other guarantee, no other assurance I can give except that God said so. And if God said so, it will come to pass. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. So there was, you can understand, telling a 14-year or 13-year-old girl, the angel comes and tells her, you're going to become a mother. And it is such an impossibility because she knew that without knowing a man, she cannot become a mother. So she asked a question. It was an impossible thing that the angel told her. Angel told her one thing. In Luke 1:35 says, the Holy Spirit will overshadow you and you will therefore, the Holy One who is to be born will be called the Son of God. So here was an impossible situation that Mary was facing. That physically it is not possible that a woman can conceive without a man. But here the angel of the Lord is telling her that the Holy Spirit will overshadow you and there will be born to you a son who will be the Son of God. I want to tell you, my dear brother, my sister, that there was such great faith in Mother Mary that day. Because otherwise, she could have doubted. You know, around the same time, there was Zachariah who got a promise of a son. He doubted, and we heard earlier, God made him mute so that he will not, through more unbelief, stop the blessings upon his life. But Mary believed. So today what I want to say is that we must have the same faith that Mary had. Because when she heard that word, she did not even question how it is going to happen. All that she did is she proclaimed one thing. Luke 1:38 says, "Then Mary said, 'Behold the maidservant of the Lord, let it be to me according to your word.'" Today I want to tell you, my dear brother minister, that is one proclamation that God wants to hear from every believer. Are you with me? From every believer, the Lord is yearning, thirsting to hear that word. Lord, here is your maidservant, or here is your manservant. Let it be unto me according to your will. That is a perfect servanthood, a perfect surrendered life. Hallelujah, hallelujah. So you'll find this is not alone. This is the Spirit of the Lord overshadowing you, and there will be born a son to you who will be called the Son of God. It's not just for Mary. I want to tell you, it is for every believer. Because God's word says in the book of John chapter 1 verse 14 that the word shall become flesh and dwell amongst us, and we will behold the glory of the word, the glory of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. So when you and I receive the word, that just like Mary received the word that the angel spoke to her, "Be unto me according to thy will," if you and I are willing to receive God's word, then that word will, just like that Mary received the word, she was conceived, and Jesus Christ was the glory of that word. Today you and I will, I'm telling you, you will be able to manifest the glory of this word if you're able to conceive this word. Are you with me? If you are able to receive the word in faith, this word will conceive in you, and you will see the glory of that word being manifested in your life. So today you and I have the same opportunity to birth Jesus. Well, are you with me? Because you understand that the word of God is Jesus. And when you are filled with the word of God, the glory of that word of God will manifest. That's what the word says. The word became flesh and dwelt amongst us, and we beheld the glory of that word. The glory of that word in the case of Mary was Jesus. Today the glory of that word will be the glory of the word which God has given us. You will see the manifestation of God's glory in our lives. So today you and I have the same opportunity like Mary had to receive the word in faith and manifest the glory of God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Because you must understand one thing, that Mary demonstrated perfect submission to God's command there. She did not question. She did not go back. I mean, she did not argue. But she just gave her life saying that here is the handmaiden of the Lord. So she did not doubt at all. So you must understand one thing, that in the book of Hebrews chapter 12 verse 1 it says, "Therefore we also since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which so easily ensnares us, and let us run with endurance the race that is set before us." So today you must understand one thing, that Mary is given to us as a person who we must emulate by her example. Because in our times of trouble or need, or where there is a conflict, or when you're going through some struggles, or there is a snare of sin that is there, it is a weight. They said, "Lay aside the weight, so which so easily ensnares us." We have to look at Mary and other people who served God and who were rewarded by God. And we know from their lives that because they were faithful to God, God has rewarded them. There are so many. Abraham is there. Paul is there. I mean, so many people are there. That is why we have decided to take on the scriptures, where we want to learn from the people who are there in the scriptures. So today, Mary is a person we have to emulate. That is, follow her example. How she was able to handle situations and use that information for our own life. Are you with me? Hallelujah. Because if you read the book of Lamentation, chapter 3 verse 22 to 24, I'll just read it out to you. The book of Lamentation, it very clearly says about the faithfulness of our God. If you put a trust in Jesus, I want to tell you, my dear brother minister, there will be no reason for you to even doubt the hand of God. It says, book of Lamentations chapter 3 verse 22 to 24 says, though the Lord's mercy, through the Lord's mercies we are not consumed, because his compassions fail not. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness. The Lord is my portion, says my soul. Therefore, I hope in him. So whatever the circumstance that is surrounding you, whatever the difficulty that you have to face, when you put your trust in God, his promise is my portion, is my inheritance. I have every right to hope in him. Again, the book of Hebrews chapter 11 verse 1 says, faith. Now faith is the substance of the things hoped for and the evidence of the things not seen. See, here one thing which you must understand, when you say now faith is a now faith. It is a time present faith. Are you with me? Today, it is a now faith. It is an active faith. So we should not have our faith on yesterday's experiences. You will be able to experience God's work in your life every day. That is where Lamentation says, it is new every morning. He demonstrates his faithfulness every morning in our lives. That is why Psalm 92 verse 1 and 2 says, it is good to give thanks to the Lord, to sing praises to you, O Most High, to declare your loving kindness in the morning and your faithfulness every night. So his faithfulness is an ongoing faithfulness. So when you give your life to Jesus, as Mary experienced that there was no need to fear. That we are able to experience the presence of God and his work in our lives. Hallelujah. Again, you understand one thing. Mary was able to understand really that if God promised something, it will be for his good, for our good only. He will never tell you to do something which is for your detriment. Are you with me? So, again, book of Hebrews chapter 11 verse 6 says that now faith is what? Without faith it is impossible to please God, and those who come to him must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of those who diligently seek him. That Mary knew that he was a rewarder. In the case of Mary, you will find that there was a great reward in her life, because she had the privilege, the unique privilege of being the biological mother of Jesus. Because Jesus was able to understand, God was able to assess that here was a person who was is a perfect servant, who had perfect humility and a perfect availability or receptivity to God's word. So when you're able to understand that, then my dear brother, my sister, what I want to tell you, God's assurances become reality in your life. Like if you read the book of Romans chapter 8 verse 28, we all know, it says, and all things, and therefore all things work together for good, for those who love God, and for those who are called, the called, according to his purpose. But do we, when we go through some bad times, are we able to put our trust in that word? Yes, if you are able to, I want to tell you, I want to urge you that you will experience a mighty presence of God and his glory in your life. So it is not the circumstance. So Mary did not shy away from that impossibility. The situation was impossible as far as our human intellect is concerned. Today often we judge the word in our intellect. My dear brother, my sister, I want to tell you, just bring it out a little more and then you will come to a heart. If you are able to assess it and understand it in your heart, then you will be able to be the beneficiary of God's blessings in your life. So again, words like the book of John chapter 3 verse 16. We all know that. It says, God so loved the world, so that he gave his only begotten son, that whoso believeth in him shall not perish but have everlasting life. It is such an awesome word. It's such an awesome word demonstrating the love of God. But many people are not able to even comprehend that. Because here is an assurance that if you put your trust in Jesus, you will not perish. But on the contrary, if you do not put your trust in Jesus, you will perish. You will surely perish. But people are really not able to understand those words. So today you and I, as Mary, you must understand one thing, that when God says something, it will be done. It will come to fulfillment. That when he says that he has given his only begotten son, that whoso believeth in him shall not perish, which means if you put your trust in Jesus, you will not perish. There is no question of your perishing. I want to tell you, my dear brother, my dear sister, I want to tell you that if you have given your life to Jesus, whatever the circumstance that you are in, you will not perish. Hallelujah. Again, the word of God says in the book of Romans chapter 10 verse 9, he says, if you confess with your lips that Jesus Christ is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. Hallelujah. See, these are all assurances that God has given. If you're able to put a trust, just like Mary put a trust in God's word, that she will conceive and she will bring forth a son who is a son of God. She put a trust in it without questioning the workability of that word. Today, you and I, if you are able to put our trust, that if I confess with my lips that Jesus is my Lord, and if I believe in my heart that God raised him from the dead, I will be saved. Because, why? Because when I am under the Lordship of Jesus, my life is given to him. I am led by the Spirit of God, and therefore I am a son of God. Therefore, my final resting place is in the house which God said, I am building for you. In the book of John chapter 14, he says, I am building many mansions for you. I will come back and take you there to occupy those mansions. Because I am a member of the household of God, as the book of Ephesians chapter 2 says, I am a member of his household. Therefore, if I am under the Lordship of Jesus, I am saved. Why? Again, God rose from the dead so that he will go forth there and he will plead with his own blood, saying that here is a price paid for the sins of you. Are you with me? He has risen from the dead and he has justified you before the Father. The law, the requirement, the just requirement of the law has been fulfilled. That is why the Word of God says in the book of Romans that he is just and a justifier. He is just because he has come not to set aside the law, but to fulfill the law. He is a justifier because he has paid the price for my sin. Are you with me? So you understand, these are things which you must believe. Believe like Mary believed. Again, the book of Romans chapter 3 verse 24-25. I must read this. I want to tell you, my dear brother, my sister, this is such a great assurance. If you read the word of God and if you believe in it and say, and if you claim the word, say, God's word says, if you believe it, let it happen to you according to your faith. Then I want to urge you, my dear brother, my sister, read your scripture carefully. Even if you're not able to complete one chapter a day, don't bother. If you're able to even complete one line, one verse is enough. Because the centurion said, Lord, just say one word and my servant will be healed. Are you with me? One word is enough. If you can really get pregnant with that word. Oh, are you with me? Hallelujah. The book of Romans chapter 3. Oh, such beautiful assurances. We sang a song, Blessed Assurance. I tell you, these are the assurances that we must really cling on to. Maybe I don't get a physical healing. Don't bother. Maybe my finances are not all that high. Don't bother. Maybe I have a lot of other physical problems. Forget it. But these are the assurances which you must cling on to and always thank the Lord Jesus. He says, for all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God, being justified freely by his grace through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus, whom God set forth as a propitiation by his blood through faith to demonstrate his righteousness. Because of his forbearance, God has passed over the sins that were previously committed to demonstrate at the present time his righteousness, that he might be just and the justifier of those who have faith in Jesus Christ. Oh, hallelujah. Such a powerful word this is. So I want to tell you one thing. If you're giving your life to Jesus, the blood of Jesus will stand as a testimony for your justification. That blood cannot be taken away. It has been shed 2,000 years ago at the cross at Calvary as a public demonstration of the sacrifice which has given us the right to become sons and daughters of God. Hallelujah. So today you must understand that this is the type of faith that you must have. An unconditional faith. Look at Mary, if you look at again. Look at the situation that she was in. She was a young girl, maybe 13, 14, like I said, just betrothed to Joseph. And like any young girl would be so thrilled about the marriage which is going to take place. Maybe, usually they say it takes about 1 year because they are betrothed. I mean, at the young age, they're betrothed and, you know. So you must understand the excitement that she was in. Hallelujah. But at the call of God, she was able to set aside all that excitement and say, Lord, here I am, your maidservant. Let it be to me according to your will. How many of us are willing to do that, my dear brother, my sister? We have got so many plans in our lives. But when something comes, God's plan is clashing with your plan. How many of us will willingly set aside our plan and say, Lord, let your plan be my plan? She did it. She did not look at the consequences at all. She blindly, because she knew here was God's word in her life. Because she knew that God created her for his glory. And if this was what was required to give him glory, and this she will do. Even if whatever be the consequences, and consequences, my dear brother, my sister, are not just ordinary. If you look at, one is that she is willingly exposing herself to all the slander and the gossip and the criticism of that society. Can you imagine today if there is an unwed mother, or rather not mother, she's about to give birth, she's pregnant and there is no husband. You can understand what people will be talking behind her back. So can you imagine, it should have been such a public scandal. It's not like today's modern society where unwed mothers is a common thing. In India it is becoming common. In Europe it is very common. And even, you know, two men having a child, you know, all these things have become so ordinary. People don't even, you know, and some places to criticize gay, this thing is an offense. You could go behind bars. But not in those times. In those times, I want to tell you, the Jewish law was that if a person is found to be pregnant outside wedlock, that is out of adultery, what is the punishment? You are stoned to death. This was the consequence that she was facing, having accepted God's word. So today I want to tell you, my dear brother, minister, often in our lives also you will find, you come to certain things, there is certain risk. We started this on risky faith. There's certain risk in giving, in believing God's word and acting accordingly. Suppose that was not there, that stoning because of adultery is not there. And she was going around telling, yes, there was an angel who appeared to me. And he said that I will conceive a son by the power of the Holy Spirit. And he shall be the son of God. Then what does that amount to? Blasphemy. Blasphemy, what is the punishment? Again, stoning to death. So death was inevitable. Hello, are you with me? Are you with me? Her one decision, death was inevitable for her. But she did not look at the consequences. She looked at only obeying God's word. Today I want to urge you, those people who are so much in love with Mary, what you should do is emulate the quality and the character of Mary. That I do not look at the consequences of obedience to God's word. I am going to obey God's word, whatever be the consequence. It is not just having a photo of her or a statue of her. No, that is just useless. If you are such an ardent believer and a lover of Mary, you must emulate her. I would mean a person you are very fond of, a person you really adore. What do? You try to emulate his good qualities. Are you with me? Hello? You try to emulate the good qualities of a person you really appreciate. So if you appreciate Mary, then you appreciate the unconditional obedience to God's word. That is what you should emulate. Hallelujah. Every believer, irrespective of which denomination, if you love Mary, you will emulate her. Hallelujah. There is no point praying or lighting candles before her. Emulate her. That is what is important. What she said is, let it happen to me according to your will. His will is revealed here in the God's scriptures. So you must be able to do anything. You must be willing to give anything. Today people are so reluctant. They cannot give their time. They cannot give their money. They cannot give. So many things come into the way. But for Mary, even her own life was of no consequence. Because she considered obeying God's word as of paramount importance in her life. She was able to prioritize her life, saying that first, I'm going to obey God's word. And secondary, all the other things. She was able to really understand, seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all the things that you need will be added unto you.